one of the recent developments in the arena of financial reporting is the introduction of IFRS 15, which was adopted by India as IND-AS 115. So what is this IND-AS 115 even talking about, and why was it necessary for us to bring up a new standard altogether? When I say IND-AS 115, it is basically revenue from contracts with customer . It deals with revenue received from contracts entered into with the customers. This is a direct replica of what we have understood under IFRS 15. While IND-AS 115 is effect from 1st of April 2018, IFRS 15 was also predominantly around the same date. He said IFRS 15 would be adopted starting from 1st of January 2018. That is the only difference that you see. But as such, if you understand, it's a straight replica of what the standard talks about. So I'm saying that this is direct adoption of IFRS 15, which was with effect from 1st of Jan 2018. A long history goes into IFRS 15, guys, because actually it was supposed to be introduced in the year 2016 itself, because it was given on 26th of Feb 2016. However, it was withdrawn a year later. It was withdrawn again in 2016, saying that the standard may not be adopted in the same sense. But however, it was reintroduced at a later point of time, saying that it is effective mandatorily from 1st Jan 2018, with India adopted as IND-AS 115 with effect from 1st of April 2018. Now, when we are discussing about this, the need of IFRS 15 is something that we have to really concentrate upon, because we had multiple guidance and multiple standards which were dealing with revenue recognition process. Now, if I look at IFRS 15, add IAS 11. IAS 11 used to deal with revenue. What sort of revenue? Revenue from good or service, revenue from renting, and revenue from dividends, royalties, etc. Everything discussed as a part of IAS 18 or IAS 11 or IAS 11. Then we had IAS 18. It was dealing with construction contracts. Then we had SIC 31, which we were talking about barter revenue, revenue from barter transactions. Then we had IFRIC 13, customer loyalty programs. Then we had IFRIC 15, which used to deal with real estate transactions. Finally, we had IFRIC 18, which was dealing with transfer of assets from customer. This way, just one topic of revenue was fragmented and divided into multiple standards. And the dividend and interest income, which was discussed as a part of IAS 11, was again discussed as a part of IND-AS 109 or your IFRS 9. Now, why do two standards have to deal with the same thing, conflicting views altogether? So we need a restructuring of this, all this ambit, the entire set of revenue recognition process. We had to harmonize, synchronize everything into one single voice or one single pen and paper, which talks about a complete ambit of revenue recognition. So all these things were put together, they were combined, and then came the evolution of one single standard, IND AS 115 or IFRS 15. This is a combined effect of two bodies. One is the International Accounting Standards Board and the FASB. FASB is basically a US group which gives US GAAP. So they have combined together, they have pooled their resources to generate one single set of accounting standard which deals with only the revenue recognition process from all these sort of transactions. That is the significance of what IND AS 115 is. IND AS 115 does not talk about one single thing. The reason why you see that IFRS 15 or IND AS 115 is voluminous is because of so many things completely discussed only as per one single standard. Revenue recognition on today's world, after the e-commerce got introduced, after you find a lot of advertisement revenue being generated, is quite complex by its sense. So we have combined everything, dealing it only as a part of IND AS 115 or IFRS 15. Now, earlier, when we talk about the previous set of standards that we have, probably the IND AS 11, IND AS 18, or you're going even further back, you have AS 7, AS 9, which are talking about construction contracts, revenue recognition process, and all that. The fundamental idea of recognizing revenue was revolving around a term called as risk and rewards. I don't know if how many of you remember this word, but the fundamental idea of recognizing revenue, the pivot role was being played by the risk and rewards. If the risk and rewards of a particular good or a service get transferred to the customer, that is an indicator of revenue recognition. However, this standard moves away from this word slightly from risk and rewards, and it falls into another word called as control and deals with something called as performance obligations. These are the two words which are significantly used in the standard, keeps popping up again and again. Get at least accustomed to these words from here on. The words are called as control over the goods and service and performance obligation in a contract. These are the two pivot positions that it actually occupies. And he says revenue can be recognized either at a point of time or over a point of time or over a period of time. Now, at a point of time means at that point of time, you need to recognize revenue because your obligation is complete. If my obligation will be complete by generating or doing that activity over a period of time, then I'll say that the revenue is recognized over a period of time and not at a point of time. So obligation which is satisfied at the point of time, obligation satisfied over a period of time. These are also dealt in the standard so that the construction contracts can also be made as a part of IND AS 115 itself. Now, this is fundamentally our idea or the basic framework around which your IFRS 15 or IND AS 115 is based on. Now, as we look at this, we also have to look at what are the exclusions from the scope of the standard. What are the exclusions from the scope of IND AS 115? Certain standards are pulling separately or deal specifically about certain sort of revenue which is not covered under IND AS 115. One such standard which we already know is IND AS 17, which deals with leases. Other one is IND AS 104, which deals with revenue from insurance contract. Which is a separate ambit completely. IND AS 32, 107, 109. 110, 111, 27, 28. All these are 110, 111, 27 and 28. These four standards deal with group companies, subsidiaries, joint arrangements and associates. 32, 107 and 109 are financial instruments. Because the dividend and interest income arising from these contracts are not covered under IFRS 15. They're specifically covered under these standards. Contractual rights and obligations in financial instruments. Now, along with that, there's one more exclusion that we have to talk about, which is very, very critical. This exclusion, which I'm talking about right now, is quite critical because, like I told you, it's quite specific to certain kind of transaction. What kind of transactions am I talking about? Such kind of transactions are non-monetary exchanges. They deal with non-monetary exchange of goods. Exchange of goods between entities within the same industry. There's a non-monetary exchange of goods within the same industry between entities to facilitate the sale to a customer. So I'll write it. I'll tell you what it is. It is a non-monetary exchange of goods between entities of same industry to facilitate sale. What does this mean? I am indicating towards, let's say the example given in the standard deals with two oil manufacturing companies. I have a potential customer who has approached A saying that he needs a particular quantity of oil. A, unfortunately, at that given point of time did not have oil in its resource. So what it has done? It has sought help from B, which is also an entity within the same industry, asking B to transfer the required quantity for making sure that the sale happens to the customer. B transferred the goods to A. A sold it to the customer. As soon as A got the production back into his pocket, he transferred it back to B. If you observe between A and B are not customers. A and B are two entities within the same industry. Why is this exchange happening? B facilitated A at a point of time to facilitate the sale so that the sale can happen. A, after its production has again come back to the level, it has again remitted it back to B. So this is only a non-monetary exchange. There's no money being transferred out here. It's a non-monetary exchange of goods which happened between both, between two entities of the same industry so that they facilitate the sale to customer. Such kind of contracts are also excluded from the ambit of Ind AS 115. So what we have understood so far is a lot of standards which were prevalent earlier prior to the introduction of Ind AS 115 have been brought into one single line after the introduction of IFRS 15 or Ind AS 115 with effect from 1st April 2018. That means the first set of financial statements which will be prepared under Ind AS 115 should be for the financial year 18-19 and for the year ended on 31st March 2019. And when we're talking about exclusions from the scope of the standard, I said there are certain standards which specifically deal with revenue and will not be covered under IFRS 15. One is Ind AS 17, which deals with leases, 104, which deals with revenue contracts, and all your contracts which are under financial instruments covered as per 32, 107, 109 or group entities between 110, 111, 27 and 28. Along with this, one more exclusion that we have seen is a non-monetary exchange of goods between two parties or two entities which are within the same industry. Now, why did this non-monetary exchange happen? A transfer, B transfer goods to A again transferred the goods to B. Why did this happen? So that they can facilitate the sale. See, this is the exclusion from the scope. We haven't still started the standard. We were only looking at the background of the standard. Now, we have to first understand who is this contract, who is this, what is a contract, and who is the customer. This is the starting point of the standard where we understand what a customer is and what a contract is. Yes, guys, like the name suggests, IND AS 115 deals with revenue from contracts with customer. I'll talk about this word contract later on because we have an in-depth evaluation of what a contract is, when to segregate a contract, when to bifurcate a contract. We have a lot of discussions to be done with a contract when it gets amended as well. So let's talk about this term customer, because even the word customer makes some sense, because there is a lot of emphasis which is laid on this term customer. When I say a word customer, we have to understand what does this word customer really stand for. When I say customer, I basically indicate towards customer is a party. Party who contracted with the entity, a party who has contracted with the entity to obtain goods and services. Which are an output of entity's ordinary activities. For a consideration. What are we talking about here? A party who has contracted with an entity to obtain goods and services which are an output of entity's ordinary activities for a consideration. Now, when we're looking at such kind of transaction in a simple sense, the most essential element here is a good and service has to be an output of entity's ordinary activities. Now, it is an output of entity's ordinary activities in the sense, if an entity is dealing with furniture, the wood which they purchase is a raw material. The fevicol which they use is a raw material. The polish which they use is a raw material. The hardware which is used as nuts and bolts are a raw material. The output of entity's ordinary activities is the fully made furniture, either in the form of a chair or a table or anything else. Now, these are ordinary activities. Now, when you look at ordinary activities, he clearly used the word consideration as well. Now, at the same time, he says a counterparty cannot be called as a customer. Who is a counterparty? Let's say I have engaged another entity along with my entity to perform a particular activity. For example, a development agreement. What happens in a development agreement? There's a landowner, there's a developer. The landowner and the developer come together to construct a commercial structure which can be sold to the customer. The landowner and the developer per se, you cannot call them as a contract at all between the customers, because these two share risks and rewards in providing an output to the customer. So the fundamental idea here is the counterparties share risk and rewards to produce an output. To be transacted with the customers. These people cannot be called as customer under Ind AS 115. So this is what we have been understanding so far. So if I start looking at the way that the transaction is being shaped up, I can simply say that a customer is a party to an entity to whom the entity transfers. They have contracted for a transfer of, what do they transfer? These people transfer goods and services which is an output of entity's ordinary activity. For an exchange of what? Only unilateral contracts cannot be considered. A unilateral contract means only one single performance is there. The other performance should be in the form of a consideration paid. A consideration which is paid by the party to the entity. This in simple sense can be called as a contract with a customer. And this is how we identify a customer. Now, fundamentally, the standard deals with a five-step approach. For recognizing revenue. What is this five-step approach for recognizing revenue? We will break down each one and learn separately. Recognition of revenue. This is broken down into five steps. What is the five-step approach that we have to talk about? The first thing, the first step that we have to talk about here is to identify a contract. First thing that we do is identify a contract. This is a prima facie thing. That's the reason why I said contract, I'll deal it separately, because we have an elaborate discussion to be done under a contract. How to identify a contract, how to separate a contract, how to modify a contract, what is to be done, what treatments are supposed to be done, separate, elaborate discussion that needs to happen here. Identify the performance obligations. What are the obligations under the contract? The customer has an obligation to pay the consideration. The entity has a obligation to deliver the goods and services. Determine transaction price. What is a consideration? You first determine that. Once you identify the performance obligation and determine the transaction price, then allocate transaction price to performance obligations. And finally, the last and the most important step is the object of the standard to recognize revenue. Recognize revenue on or when the entity satisfies performance obligation. So we are saying there are five-step approach that we have to follow. Identify a contract, that is the first one. What is the transaction price? What are the obligations under the contract? Allocate the consideration to the obligations under the contract and then recognize revenue. This is a five-step approach which is given in the standard, but an elaborate discussion goes into each certain step. So let's start with identifying the contract, which forms the first step of revenue recognition process defined under Ind AS 115. Step number one under Ind AS 115 to recognize revenue is to identify a contract. What is a contract as per Ind AS 115 will be the prima facie question which should be first answered under Ind AS 115. Identification of contract. First of all, what is a contract which should be considered under Ind AS 115? When I say contract, contract is basically enforceable under court of law. It is an agreement between parties which is enforceable in court of law, and such contract can either be written or it can be oral or it can be implied by customary practices of the enterprise. Written, oral or implied contracts are identified under Ind AS 115. And we are also going across to say that such contracts are agreements between parties which are enforceable in court of law. They're agreements between parties which are enforceable in court of law. So should be legal terms. It should be a contract which should be under the Contract Act 1856, and we have to make sure that these arrangements are done, agreements are done between parties for exchange of goods for a consideration. Now such contracts are the ones which are identified under Ind AS 115. Now at the same time, we'll also have to look at what are the essential elements of a contract. When we're talking about the essential elements of a contract which have to be taken into consideration, now this is a good exercise to understand what it is. Essential elements of contract. The essential elements of a contract to be covered under Ind AS 115, I can broadly classify them into five parts. Five steps for revenue recognition, five parts for identifying a contract. Now, what is a contract under Ind AS 115 and what are the essential elements of the contract? The first one, that the contract has a commercial substance. First one, that the contract has a commercial substance. It should not be a transaction which lacks a commercial substance. What is a commercial substance? That means it can be measured in terms of money, which is the most important thing. And it should be an exchange which happens between unrelated parties. Now, that is basically what we are indicating with the word called as commercial substance. Now, when we look at the word commercial substance and going further, what are the other elements of the contract? He says, it should be approved by the parties. And are committed to perform obligations. What obligations? Those obligations which are a part of the contract, they have to be performed by these parties who have approved the contract. Approval means either it can be a written, oral, or an implied approval. Whatever it is, it should be approved by both the parties, and they are committed to perform those contractual obligations. Moving forward, identify rights to goods and services whose rights, each party's rights. What is the right of the buyer? What is the right of the seller on those goods and services? The right of the buyer to reject if they are not legitimate, if they are not as per the requirement. A right of the seller to charge a consideration. A right of the seller to have the possession of the goods until the performance obligation is complete. The right of the seller to use different materials in satisfying the contract. These are rights to goods and services which have to be identified. Also identify the payment terms. The seller and buyer should identify the payment terms. When is the payment due? When is the payment supposed to be received? What are the payment terms? Payment by check, payment by DD, or a prior advance 50%, or whatever, there's a retention money. So all these are identifiable payment terms which both the parties should understand or should identify to form part of a contract. At the same time, the consideration is probable to be collected. What is this word probable to be collected, and when do you say that a consideration is probable? When I'm looking at this contractual arrangements and we are saying that the identifying the contract, the most important element here would be that the payment is probable. When do you say that the payment is probable? A payment is said to be probable when the customer has an ability to pay, not sufficient, and intention to pay. When they have an ability as well as an intention to pay the consideration under the contract, then you can say that the consideration is probable to be collected. So these are the essential elements which form part of a contract. So what are we looking at? We said it should have a commercial substance. That means it should have, it should be measurable in terms of money between two unrelated parties, only dealing with such goods and services irrespective of any other dealings within between those parties. Number two, both the parties should have approved for the terms, and also they are committed to perform their obligations under the contract. Number three, they should identify their rights and duties with respect to those goods and services being transacted. Number four, they should identify the payment terms under the contract. How much is to be paid in advance? Whether the payment should be done by cash or by check, whatever is the mode of payment, entire thing is covered under the payment terms. And finally, the probability of consideration being received by the seller. Now, whenever you say probability, I said the customer should have an intention to settle the amount along with his ability to pay. I have an ability, but I don't intend to pay. Cannot be considered as a contract. I have an intention to pay, but I don't have the ability. It is not my capacity to pay so much of high amount. Then why did you take my service? Why did you take my goods? Now, such kind of contracts will not form part of Ind AS 115. Now, also talking about exclusions, we say that contracts where each party, we have two parties in the contract, they have a unilateral right they have a unilateral right. Unilateral means without the consent of the other party. I want to. That's it. Other party's intention is not required here. Unilateral right to terminate the contract, terminate the wholly unperformed contract is excluded from IND AS 115. What is this I'm talking about? A contract where each of the party has a unilateral right to terminate the contract which is wholly unperformed. What is this word wholly unperformed? And what is this word unilateral right? Unilateral right means without the consent of the other party, each party have a right to terminate the contract wholly unperformed. What is wholly unperformed? That means none of the parties have performed their contractual obligation. If I deliver the goods, you have to pay me the money. I did not deliver, you did not pay. Wholly unperformed contract. Or I have delivered a part of the goods for which you have already made the part payment. So that is also a wholly unperformed contract. Such kind of wholly unperformed contract, if one of the party or any of the party to the contract have a right to terminate the contract without the consent of the other party, then they should not be concerned under IND AS 115, because we clearly said it should be approved by the parties, but means both the parties should be under the arrangement. One party does not have a right to terminate the contract, and if it does have a right, it should not be covered under IND AS 115. This is not the alone discussion under contract. We'll also have to look at when a combination of contracts happen and when you have a contract modifications, what is the treatment to be done? Yes, guys. So very important point to be noted in IND AS 115 is about segregation and combination of contracts. Now, the first concept is, why does this discussion even arise that we have to combine or segregate a contract? In a simple sense, let's say multiple contracts are entered into at the same point of time. For example, let's say I have a piece of land. Let's say this is a piece of land which I have. On this piece of land, we are trying to construct three complexes or three buildings. Is a building A, B, and C. Three buildings which I have named them as. Now the peculiar here is that A, B, and C have three different purposes. Let's say this A was a commercial complex. While this B was a hotel, and the C was a residential premises. There are some flats which are being built. Now, in this fashion, when I have three different buildings which are constructed on the same piece of land, and I have entered into three contracts, one with each one of them, A, B, and C, the question here is about combination and segregation of contracts. When do you say that all the contracts will belong to the same, whether A, B, and C combined will be taken as one single contract, or A is a separate contract, B is a separate contract, and C is a separate contract? Now, the question normally comes up because all the three contracts are either entered at the same point of time with the same party, or they're almost entered at the same near point of time. That means there's a gap of very marginal number of days between entering into all the three contracts. So this is a point which normally comes up. I've contracted with the same party and all the three contracts were entered into almost at the same point of time or at the same point of time. Now, in such instance, A, B, and C, whether we have to deal it as a separate contract or a same contract is a question which is dealt in the standard as segregation and combination of contracts. Now, the issue of segregation and combination with contracts normally arises because multiple contracts are entered at the same point of time or near the same point of time. Multiple contracts are entered into at the same point or near the same point. In such case only we get this instance of we have to decide whether we have to combine or segregate the contracts. To deal with this, we have to look at three different conditions for combining the contracts. We are basically looking at three different conditions for combining a contract, and if none of these three conditions are satisfied, you can treat A, B, and C as a complete different contract. What are the three conditions that I'm talking about? Number one, the contracts are negotiated as a single package, as one single package that you have negotiated the contract with and have a single commercial objective. That means I'm negotiated like this. For the entire project put together, A, B, and C put together, I'm giving you one single package of 400 crores. One single package. That is the first condition. The second condition, the price and performance of one contract is dependent upon the performance of the other contract. If you complete A, then only I would give you B. If you complete A and B, then only I'll give you C. Or, since I've only already given you A and B, C, you make sure that your price is reduced. So my price or performance is dependent on the other contract, then you cannot say that they are separate contracts, they should be combined as one single contract. Number three, they more or less represent a same, they constitute, all the contracts constitute for a single performance obligation. They constitute for a single performance obligation. In such instance, you cannot separate the contracts. They have to be treated as single construction contract. So I'm saying the first one here, which we have to talk about, first one is they're negotiated as a single package. They're negotiated as a single package with a single commercial objective. I'll come back to the example and I'll take and I'll try to apply, guys. The first one I'm taking, that they are negotiated as a single package, have a single commercial objective. This is the first one. The second one which we have to discuss here is, I said that the price and performance of one contract is dependent on another. The price and the performance of one contract is dependent on another contract. Second one. The third one which I'm trying to discuss here is, I'm saying that all contracts constitute a single performance obligation. They constitute for a single performance obligation. These three conditions, if they are satisfied, either of them is satisfied, then I can say that these contracts will be dealt as one single contract. So I'm separating everything by or. And if these conditions are satisfied, then I would say that these contracts will be called as one single contract, or we are going to combine these contracts. However, if your answers are no to each one of them, then we have to deal everything as a complete separate contract, or I want to treat each one as a separate contract. If none of the condition is satisfying, treat as separate contracts. So this is basically what we are talking about as far as the concerned point of combining or segregating contracts. Now, coming back to the given example which I gave you, A, B and C, where we have three buildings which are built on the same piece of land. The commercial complex is said to be let out on a monthly basis. Hotel, based on occupancy, you charge the fees. Residential premises, I have an objective to sell it. So my commercial objective among each one of them is not the same. Here I'm deriving a monthly rental or in the form of leases. Hotel is not based on lease, it is based on occupancy that you collect the fees. Residential premises, outright sale. Commercial objective is not the same. So even though you have negotiated as a single package, you can deal them as combined, you can deal them as separate contracts. Number two, if the price of the commercial complex is dependent on the price and the performance of hotel or the residential premises, then you can combine. If independently I've said A, this is the amount of, the cement which will be occupied. This is the amount of sand which will be consumed. This is the amount of steel which is necessary. This is the number of labor hours which are required. All this, if I have jotted down one by one, and if I have quoted a price for commercial complex or a hotel or residential premises separately, then each one will be treated as a separate contract. You cannot treat them as combined contracts. And then comes into situation whether everything will be dealt as single performance obligation or no. What is a performance obligation? It is a promise. That means if I have completed A and I could not complete B, am I eligible to receive the payment for A or no? If I am eligible to receive the payment for A, even though I could not complete B and C, then you can deal with each one of them as separate performance obligation. They cannot be dealt as one single performance obligation. So these are necessary conditions for combining and segregating contracts, or to be treated as separate construction contracts for recognizing revenue. So one is combination of contracts, one is separate contracts or segregation of contracts. Now, the very important question which arises at this point of time is what if? What if I've done a modification in the contract to build a peripheral wall? I have done a modification in the contract to build a peripheral wall. It was not there in the original contract. Now I am inserting this clause of building a peripheral wall. Also to build the road from the entrance leading towards this A, B and C. I am also asking him to build a water tank here. Now additional contracts or additional things have come in. be it the compound wall, be it the roads, internal roads being laid, or be it the water tank that you built, be it any other additional contract that you're doing, such things will be considered as modification to the original contract. Now the question arises, can I deal with the modification as a part of the original contract, or should I deal with this modification as a separate contract? Now that will be the very important question to answer regarding modification of contracts, whether the modification itself is treated as a separate contract or it will be treated as a part of the original contract itself will be a very important question to answer. So the next topic under Ind AS 115 will be about modification of contracts. So let's discuss about modifications. Modifications in a contract are common because probably I might have contracted with a party initially on specific terms, and these specific terms are bound to change at a later point of time, depending on the requirements of the market or depending on the changing needs of the customer. Now, in such instances, like I've given you the previous example, where I've included a new things into the contract, like a compound wall or an internal roads or the water tank being built, these are additional items or distinct additional items which are added to the contract. Such distinct items additional to the contract, should I treat these modifications as a separate contract or should I treat it as a part of the original contract is the question which is being asked for. So the name that we are talking about is modifications to a contract. Now, when I say modification, this modification can either refer to a change in the scope along with a change in the price, or a change in the scope alone without a change in the price, or a change in the price without a change in the scope. So I can simply put it up like this: a change in scope and or anything could be. It could be and price or price, whatever it is. So a change in the scope and the price of the contract is what we can call it as a modification to a contract. Such modification in the contract is what we have to deal with on whether the modification should be dealt as a separate construction contract or not. So to answer this question, very simple basic logic that you need to remember is that if the modification represents distinct goods or services, plus the change in price, represents standalone selling price, of distinct goods and service, in such situation, when the modification represents a distinct good or service, that means it is not similar to what was the good or service in the original contract. Whenever we have a distinct good or service which is a subject of modification, and the price with which the contract has changed is equal to the standalone selling price of these goods, that means the price of the distinct goods should not be influenced with the original contract, but it should represent a standalone selling price. And it represents distinct goods and services. If these two conditions are satisfied, then we can say that it should be treated as
the modification is equal to a separate contract.
Now, this is what modification talks about. So, if I try to indicate it like this, that the modification represents a distinct good or service, modification is equal to distinct good or service plus increase in price is equal to the standalone selling price. If these two conditions are satisfied, then I can say that it is a separate contract, or the modification should be dealt as a separate independent contract by itself. If these two conditions are satisfied, then I am saying that this can be treated as a separate contract. Such cases, I can say modification is equal to separate contract. If the modification is not of distinct goods and services, if your answer is no, if yes, then we'll go with this. But if it is no, the modification represents certain goods and items which are not distinct. That means not all goods and services are distinct. If not all goods and services are distinct, then you need to make sure that you are applying it as part of the original contract. It should not be treated as a separate contract, but it should be treated as a part of the original contract itself. Now, if I discuss about the example which I have given you, where we were talking about the building internal roads and compound wall, which was a modification to the original contract of building three towers, each tower of commercial or a hotel or a residential premises, these three towers and the road or the compound wall which is built is completely distinct. They are not similar in their utility or the function or the technology which is adopted in construction. So whenever it is such distinct in the purpose for which it is built, the technology which it uses to be built, and the utility or the function of that particular thing, then we can say that these goods are not distinct. So in such case, we will treat it as a separate contract if they are considered to be distinct. If they are not distinct, then we will treat it as a part of original contract. So what am I saying? Distinct means purpose or technology applied or the function that it does. If these three things are taken into consideration, then you can exactly understand what is a distinct good or a service. So the roads, compound wall, and the overhead tank which is being built will be considered as a separate contract, should not be treated as a modification to the original contract or a change in the original contract itself. So that was step one, where we were talking about what is a contract and how to identify a contract under Ind AS 115. We have seen five steps in revenue recognition process given under Ind AS 115. First one was identification of contract. Second one was identification of performance obligation. Third one was determination of transaction price. Number four was allocation of transaction price to performance obligations. And number five is recognition of revenue, either at a point of time or over a period of time. Now, among these five steps which are given under Ind AS 115, we have covered the first one, which was talking about identification of contract. Now, as we gradually move to the next step, which is step two in identifying a performance obligation in a contract. My step two will discuss about performance obligation in a contract. What is a performance obligation and how do I identify those performance obligation will be the primary discussion that will happen as a part of step two. What is a performance obligation? First question. When I talk about performance obligation, it is a promise. Who makes a promise? A seller makes a promise to the customer that he would deliver a certain goods and services. And the customer in return makes a promise to pay a consideration to the seller, either in the form of cash or other than cash. So whenever we are talking about typically a performance obligation, it can easily be said that it is a promise in a contract with a customer. So a performance obligation can be defined like this. It is a promise in a contract with a customer . What promise do we make? A promise to transfer what? Goods and services. Now this expression of transfer of goods and services, we will have to understand better. When I said it is a promise in the contract with the customer to deliver or to transfer goods and services, we need to understand this term goods and services better, because multiple goods transferred as a part of a contract can be identified as separate performance obligations. How do I know it? Multiple goods supplied in a contract are one performance obligation, or multiple goods supplied in a contract are they separate performance obligations? For example, when I try to basically buy a car, what do we get along with a car? We get a car along with the keys. We also get a rooftop cover on that. So all these are goods which are bundled together. They're bundled together into one unit and they're sold. He's not going to sell you tires separately or steering separately, not the, you know, the door separately, the engine separately. He's not going to sell you all these features separately. He's going to combine everything and he's going to sell it as one single unit called as a car. So when I say that I'm buying such kind of things, now how do we identify whether all the goods bundled together are one performance obligation, or each good by itself satisfies the definition of performance obligation? So we need to understand what is this transfer of good and service that he is talking about to be satisfying the word performance obligation. He says these goods and services, he says it could be a good or a service or a bundle of goods and services which are distinct . What is this word distinct? We'll understand. We'll have to understand the significance of the word being used called as distinct. We'll understand this term, but I'll just park it aside later because we'll talk about it. The second one,
is a series of distinct goods and services which are substantially similar or substantially same they are substantially same and have a similar pattern of transfer to the customer. Now we are saying they could be a bundle of goods and services which are being transferred, but or a series of goods and services which are being transferred and which are substantially the same and have a similar pattern of transfer. So I'm talking about a series of transfers. Now what is series? That means multiple goods are delivered at different points of times, like a subscription to a newspaper. What happens in a subscription to a newspaper? I took a 1 year subscription to a newspaper or a magazine. So every periodically I keep getting the delivery of those newspapers or articles. So I'm talking about series of distinct goods and services which have a similar pattern of transfer. Similar pattern of transfer to the customer. What is a similar pattern of transfer to the customer? We'll have to understand. So I'm saying it is a promise in a contract with a customer to deliver goods and services. What good and service I'm talking about? A good or a service or a bundle of goods and services which are distinct from each other. Number two, series of distinct goods and services which are similar in nature or same or substantially the same and have a similar pattern of transfer to the customer. Now this is basically what a performance obligation indicates. Now first thing that I'll have to talk about, what is the similar pattern of transfer to customer? When do I say that I have a similar pattern of transfer? What do you understand by the similar pattern of transfer to the customer? When I use this term, similar pattern of transfer to the customer, I'm basically indicating towards a certain set of goods and services which are periodically transferred in such a way that each series by itself or each set of series by itself would satisfy the condition of performance obligation. That means when I've given you the example of magazines and newspapers, each time the newspaper was delivered, it probably is a series of delivery of goods and services and each one is a part. That means one day if I receive the newspaper, to that extent, it has already satisfied the performance obligation. Or I would say that I could have a contract to purchase only one day's newspaper as well. And the delivery of one day newspaper also satisfies the condition of performance obligation. So I'm saying each distinct good or service in the series satisfies the definition of performance obligation. So I'm saying each distinct good or a service in the series satisfies the definition of performance obligation itself. That means one set of series of transfer that you do by itself will satisfy the definition. Plus, series
same method of computing the satisfaction of performance is applied. Same method of computing the satisfaction of performance is applied on each delivery of good or service. I'll tell you what it means. I'm basically putting it into two parts. I'm saying a series of distinct goods and services also satisfy the definition of performance obligation when it actually has a similar pattern of transfer to the customer. What is a similar pattern of transfer? I'm saying that means each set of goods and services in the series by itself will satisfy the definition of performance obligation. That means each time I delivered the newspaper, I satisfied a performance obligation. Though the performance in this contract predominantly is a subscription for 1 year, I agree. But each day when the newspaper got delivered, each day, the each particular day can also be called as performance obligation. Plus, if I have delivered the newspaper for 90 days out of 365 days, my performance is complete to the extent of 90 by 360. 91st day when I delivered, it became 91 by 365. If I have delivered it on 180th day, it will become 180 by 365. So a same method of computing the satisfaction for performance is applied on each delivery of this goods and service. So I'm basically predominantly putting it into two parts. I'm saying each set of the series of goods and services by themselves will satisfy the performance obligation. Number two, the same method of computing the satisfaction or same method of computing the performance obligation or satisfaction of performance obligation is applied whenever you deliver the good and service. These two put together will basically satisfy the condition for a series of distinct and goods and services satisfying your performance obligation criteria. Now, sometimes a performance obligation might not be confusing to an administrative effort. What is an administrative effort? For example, I've supplied a fridge or any other electronic or electrical equipment to you. Sometimes the seller organizes a visit to the place so that a demo is given for that particular good. When you buy an oven, someone comes up from the same seller and he will come down and he'll demonstrate that this oven has to be used like this. This is an overproof vessel. This is not an overproof vessel. So much of clarity is being given on how should we use and what we shouldn't do with that. Now, such kind of efforts are called as administrative efforts. You cannot call it as a distinct good or a service. Got it? So I'm saying performance obligation cannot be considered as an administrative service. Got it? Administrative work cannot be called as performance obligation. So this predominantly is a discussion on performance obligation, but we are not done yet because we haven't understood what is a distinct. Every time we are talking about distinct good or service satisfies performance obligation, each set of distinct goods and services should be considered as separate performance obligation. First of all, what is distinct? When do you call that a particular good or a service is distinct from each other? Now that is primarily something that we have to understand. Like I told you, whenever we have bundle of goods and services which are transacted in one particular time or near the same time, the concept arises, should I deal each good and service as a separate performance obligation or all the goods together should be considered as one single performance obligation? Now, to understand that, we have to understand the significance of this term, distinct good or a service. Let's understand. We were having a discussion about performance obligation where I said each distinct good and service should be considered as a separate performance obligation. And a bundle of goods and services, whenever they are provided in a series, each set of distinct goods and services in a series should also be considered as performance obligation if they are significantly the same and have a similar pattern of delivery or transfer to the customer. Now, like this, if I talk about distinct word, really has been echoing in my head, because what is this distinct? When do I say something is a distinct good or a service? An AC is being supplied. Now the question is, an AC being supplied along with, once the AC is given, the next day immediately a technician is going to come down to your house and fit the AC and install the AC. He's going to show it to you that the AC is working absolutely fine, without which you wouldn't accept all that good at all. Now if I'm talking about such kind of goods, I'm exactly talking about such kind of goods, when we are talking about, or when we have a delivery of a vehicle or a delivery of a equipment or an electronic or an electrical equipment which has an installation service, can I deal both of them as two different performance obligations? Delivery of good as a performance obligation, installation of the equipment as a performance obligation, can I do that? Or the good along with the installation together is one single performance obligation? How do I identify that? For to identify that, we should see whether the delivery of the good and the installation service both are distinct or not. How do I know whether they are distinct? Without even knowing or understanding what is the significance of the term distinct. So let me understand the word distinct goods and services. Let me understand this word. Distinct goods and services. What is a distinct good or a service? When do I consider a set of goods and services as distinct from each other? Now, the first explanation for distinct is going to say that the customer benefits from good or service on its own or through resources which are readily available. The customer benefits or derives a benefit from the good or service by its own. That means, irrespective of the other good or service which is being delivered in a bundle, if such good or service is giving the benefit to a customer by itself, then you can consider it as a distinct good or service. Or if the customer can get benefit through other resources which is readily available with him. What is this other good or service which is readily available? Other resources, when I use the word they are readily available, I intend to mean that this readily available means the word readily available is equal to the customer already owns that. Or it is sold separately. Either the customer already owns that particular resource, or it is sold separately, either by the seller or by any other seller, then in such situation we call it as distinct good or service which are benefiting through resources already available with the enterprise.
So when we talk about distinct goods and services, we are saying the customer benefits from the goods and service on its own or through other resources which are readily available with the enterprise. When I say readily available, it means either the customer already owns it or he can buy it separately from some other supplier. In such cases, we call it as a distinct good or a service. For example, if I am basically delivering an equipment in a CKD condition, CKD means completely knocked down. That means parts and parts and parts will come down to the place and they get assembled into one unit. Now let's say I have supplied an equipment in a CKD condition, like an AC. AC normally comes with an outdoor unit, an indoor unit, you know, those copper wires which get connected. Everything is sold separately or everything will get delivered separately, but they do not benefit the enterprise or the buyer. When do they benefit the enterprise or the buyer? When all the three are put together, the outdoor unit, the indoor unit, along with the copper wire, which is connecting both of them, if everything is put together, installed in a particular manner, technically, then only the benefit is being derived by the customer. So hence we can say that a delivery of an AC where installation services are also provided can be combined into one single performance obligation, since the delivery by itself is not giving or the customer does not derive any benefit from the delivery alone. Now, along with this, we can also say that distinct good or service means it can be separately identified. Now, what is separately identified or separately identifiable? When I use the word separately identifiable, such good or service is separately identifiable if in case we have certain things which has to be satisfied. Number one, not highly dependent on other goods and services. It does not depend upon other goods and services which are being supplied in a bundle. Or, if this is the first condition, the second one. Does not customize or modify other goods and services. Or not integrated with other goods and services. Hence, we are saying what is distinct, it should be separately identifiable. When do you call something as separately identifiable? I am saying that it is highly independent. There is nothing to do with other good or service at all. It can be identified all by itself, or it does not customize or modify any other good and service which is being supplied, or it is not integrated with other goods and services to derive any benefit. If these three conditions are satisfied, or any of these conditions is satisfied, I'll call it as separately identifiable good or service which satisfies the definition of performance obligation. So we are talking about two things. A distinct good or a service indicates a good or a service which can benefit the enterprise or the customer by itself, or with the help of resources which are available with the customer. When do you say that a resource is readily available? The resource is readily available when the customer already owns it or he can buy it from elsewhere. And then we are talking about separately identifiable goods.
A separately identifiable good or service is the one which is not dependent on any other good or service which is being supplied, does not modify or alter, customize any other good or service. It is not significantly integrated with other goods and service. It can derive benefit without integration with other goods and services itself. So if this definition is satisfied, then you can identify certain goods and services as distinct, and each such set of distinct goods and services should be treated as a separate performance obligation under step 2. Now, most of the times we have to identify performance obligations in a contract based on the facts and circumstances of a case. We cannot readily have a solution saying that this is performance obligation in this particular manner. Now, normally when an online delivery or online, the good is sold either on Amazon's or Flipkart's or Myntra's and all, you find that delivery becomes a very integral part of the service. A supply is not complete without the delivery being done. So performance cannot be completed just by placing an order with the customer, just by receiving the money with the customer. You need to ensure that the good is delivered. Only then you can say that the performance is complete. So this way we need to understand the significance and then identify what is a performance obligation. We'll completed the second step. We'll move on to the third one now.